Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good evening, and I would like to welcome everyone to the October 16th meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners. And before we begin, I'd like for Commissioner Sutton, if he would, do our invocation, please.
If we could take a moment, please. My Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to exercise one of the greatest privileges we have in this country, self-governance. Be with us as we enter into tonight's deliberations. Be with us for all future deliberations, especially going into a new season with fall. Please help us realize that we all need to enter into some thoughts of a new season in our hearts, in our minds, and in our daily dealings, in our professional and personal lives. Amen.
Amen.
That's the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, next we will have our public speakers, and just want to remind everyone, if you can limit it to 3 minutes, that would be appreciated. First, Leah Clayton.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I will be brief. I ask you to open your hearts and your minds to my rational and moral request. We as a community need to move the Confederate statue from in front of our courthouse. I believe that it is unfair to the black citizens of Alamance County to have it there. I believe that it does harm to black people in our community, and it does harm to white people too. I believe it has no place in front of a house of government justice because it does not represent the interests and well-being of all of our citizens. I propose that we move the monument to a more fair location that allows it to be in its proper historical context. This statue was erected in 1914 in a time when black citizens were losing the right to vote, and Jim Crow laws were enacted to deprive them of basic civil rights. Also during this time, an increase in lynchings and the rise of the KKK. All done to bolster white power and keep black people in an economically and socially disadvantaged place. It was during these years that this monument was erected. Today, I believe having a statue in front of our courthouse that glorifies a soldier who fought to preserve the legality of enslaving an entire group of people because they were deemed to be less than human, this negates the proposition that the American justice system treats everyone equally under the law. Many argue that the Confederate statue honors their personal family history. It is also important to consider that this history has also served to exploit, exclude, and oppress black people. In this matter, and in all decisions made on behalf of the public, the history of black people as a community should be valued as much as the history of other white community members who stand here to speak before you to defend the statue. When we deny or are complacent about the harmful nature of this statue and its location, we deny the real pain of this history for Americans of color. My own innate sense of decency tells me that the moral thing to do is to move it. Isn't this kind of kindness and true concern for everyone a real Southern value that we all share. Thank you.
All right. Melissa Peterson?
Yes. Good evening, everybody. Hey. Thanks for having me again. I'll try to make this brief. I brought a real short PowerPoint so I can stay on Cass, so he's going to present that. But my name is Melissa Peterson, and I'm with the Alamance Academy, and some of our members came along tonight. But we would like to provide integrated community services for Alamance County. And we were established in 2007. A lot of you guys may know about. We were established as a level 2 group home for boys. And over the past decade, we include services that provide holistic rehabilitation services here in Alamance County and 36 other counties and we're certified to work in. We also employ over 50 people in the county too, and we're growing that. We strive to provide an enriching environment that promotes healthier relationships with the community and increase the chances of independent living for our consumers and members. We offer residential services, mental health assessments, individual support services, SAOP, which is substance abuse outpatient services. We do outpatient therapy, also trauma-focused therapy. We do peer support services, individual support services. We help with housing, employment, linkage, and we also do services for the blind. We just became a vendor to do that. And we just kind of show some pictures of some of the families that we have impacted through some of our peer support services. We've helped people that are homeless find housing, link them into job opportunities, and different things like that. We want to expand those impacts here in Alamance County. And so those are some of the envisions that we have at the Community Services of Alamance County, that we want to help with housing, food, nutrition, employment, health, and education, and also link in with other nonprofits to help support those things. And we feel that just one large site, because right now we're spread out in a lot of different places, that would enhance the services that we're able to provide for the community too, and also help with employment and job opportunities for people and training. And so we want to boost the effectiveness of each partner's organizations or nonprofits and collaborate, which would be a real benefit for all the citizens of Alamance. And that's what we want to, you know, we're just kind of making that vision come true, like realizing the clinic, reviving the clinic. We want to revive the clinic.
Thinking ahead, right?
We want to revive it. Yeah, so that's about the end of it, and I appreciate the time and the consideration of the board.
We will talk about that later, too.
Okay.
So we may have some questions for you then.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next, DeLacy Jacobs.
Yes, my name is DeLacy Jacobs, and I am a peer support with Alamance Academy. We reach out and do many things for our individuals in the community. Like Melissa stated, we have to find jobs, housing, food, clothing. We do all the above because we want them to have a good impact on not on themselves, but Alamance County. With a little boost, a little shove, they can do it. They just need that little push, they can do it. Thank you.
Thank you. Barbara, not sure, Saul, maybe? Yeah. Barbara. Okay.
It's not her.
There's a Barbara Clapp. All Barbaras stand up.
I was telling them I didn't know what I was signing out there. I'm going to stop signing my name.
You get a bill later.
But anyway, I'm Barbara. I work at Alamance Academy. I'm one of the peer support supervisors. We're looking to get a bigger place, like Mo was saying, so we can be all in one facility and expand our business. We hoping, look forward to getting that building.
Okay.
All right,
very
thanks.
Good. Thank you. Barry Joyce.
It's old. If I crawl up here, that back surgery.
Showing how old you are, Barry.
Huh?
Showing how old you are.
Yeah, me and you about getting there, aren't we? On the other side of 12 o'clock.
That's right.
Now, I'm here to talk about a couple of things. One, this statue thing. I just have heard a bunch about it. I think we could remedy this all by putting something in front of the statue saying, this is so we never forget. And then that makes everybody happy, you know, because that really should be a reminder of that atrocity, and it should be put out there so we never forget what happened. But anyway, basically what I'm here for is try to save some people's lives in Alamance County. You're going to have the EMS director come up here in a few minutes and offer an agenda to purchase three of these Lucas machines, which are CPR compression machines. We only have like two or three now. So basically what it amounts to is some people in the county have a better chance of living than others. And my understanding is the protocol for CPR in this county is the volunteer fire departments do the CPR. And they do CPR until the ambulance gets there. And then they continue to do CPR after the ambulance gets there so that the paramedics can go ahead and start administering fluids, whatever, to try to save the person's life. The Lucas machine is way, way more efficient than mandatory compressions. Pumps a lot more blood to the heart, a lot more oxygen. It's just a lot better chance of survival. We've had them, I think they're scattered out now. We don't have one at AO Fire Department. I'm in Fawcett, but the odds of him getting there, you know, in time is not good. And, you know, the only way he's going to beat the EMTs there is for him to just happen to be riding by and the call come in. It's a $18,000 piece of equipment. We need one in every fire department. Doesn't need to be paid for by the fire department. It needs to be paid for by the citizens of Alamance County. And, you know, I just want everybody in this county to have an equal chance of living. And if you pick and choose which fire departments have them or which, you know, EMS people have them, then you're basically saying, you know, you got a better chance if you live in this fire district than you do in this fire district. It's not a big expenditure for what we're doing. And it's one of the most effective things out there for saving lives. So I'd just like to ask, I know they're asking for three, it's on the agenda. I'd just like to ask that we buy enough for each fire department. I've talked to the firemen. They'd love to have them. Their success rate would go up. I've got a fireman that mows for me, two firemen that mows for me, one in McLeansville and one in Alamance County. So I'm getting to hear them from both sides, Guilford and Alamance. And in Guilford, they have them. And one of the guys that works in Babin, and, you know, he's done a lot of CPR with not much success. And, you know, it bothers him, and, you know, he feels like we need it. And the other firemen I've talked to feel like we need it. And, you know, I would just like to see the county. I think it'd be a good expenditure. I think the public citizens, I know I couldn't lay down at night wondering, you know, should I approve this or not approve it, you know, if I'm going to save a life and not save a life. So I'd ask that you really consider that. I think it'd be one of the best expenditures you'd probably ever make in this county. And, I appreciate your time, and I'm going to crawl back to the seat and get off his leg.
Thank you, Barry. Bob Creighton.
Thank you, Chairman and Commissioners. I want to address the Commissioners tonight on Cardinal Innovations oversight fate that affects approximately 35,000 Alamance residents. When, if at all, the day of reckoning comes depends essentially on whether the state health secretary, Dr. Mandy Cohen, is willing to assert her oversight authority by state law. Only the Cardinal Board and the state health secretary have the ability to replace the CEO as Cardinal's chief executive. Two recent scathing state audits have questioned Cardinal's financial status, in particular board-approved executive compensation and severance packages. We would not expect the state health secretary to take such action without some type of transition period that would allow the county to make arrangements for services. In any case, we should take whatever actions necessary to ensure services are continued for our county residents residents, having a contingency plan just in case. A former board member and several behavioral health advocates are calling for Dr. Cohen to remove all Cardinal board members who are failing to provide strong oversight and undermining taxpayers with misaligned priorities. In June of 2016, the Macquarie administration submitted a hybrid reform plan that allows a role for up to three commercial insurers in providing prepaid health plans statewide and not-for-profit health groups supporting up to 12 regional provider-led entities. And Cohen Health has already been approved as one PLE. And Alamance alone, Cardinal is directly responsible for supporting a provider network that has provided thousands of walk-in services that could have otherwise gone to local emergency rooms. You know, more than, I'm not sure the count, but our people are the ones who suffer the lack of honest, caring leadership in mental health agencies and state administration and our legislature, who is only now raising an eyebrow at the amazing thing that has happened with public dollars recently, and some of the words that have been used by lawmakers include irresponsible, unbelievable, exorbitant, arrogant, greedy, egregious, avarice, and unconscionable to describe the spending at North Carolina's largest behavioral health management company during a legislative hearing Tuesday. And that's all I wanted to bring to your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob, for bringing that up. All right. Commissioner responses to any of the comments?
Yeah, I'd like to make a couple of comments. Mm-hmm. First of all, I'd like to thank Ms. Clayton for speaking as she did in support of moving the monument. At the September 5th meeting, I spoke on, made a lot of points that were similar to Ms. Clayton's, the fact that this was an era of Jim Crow when our monument was erected. I mentioned that our governor, Governor Aycock, who was elected in 1900, made some pretty white supremacist remarks publicly. I mentioned the some of the white supremacist remarks that were made at the dedication of our own monument, at the dedication of the Silent Sam Monument. So I understand where Ms. Clayton is coming from, and I agree with her. This past Thursday, my wife and I attended an exhibit at the North Carolina, I forget the exact name, the Museum of Natural Sciences, I think it is, in downtown Raleigh. The exhibit was entitled Race. And it's been there for a couple of months. I think there are three of these exhibits traveling around the country. And the one in Raleigh will be there through this coming Sunday, the 22nd. And I would invite everybody to go see that because it really exhibits and displays some history that, and some facts about race and racism that a lot of us really aren't that cognizant about. Then Friday and Saturday, I spent two full days at a workshop on racial equity and racism. This was the third time that this workshop has come to Alamance County, and I've attended each one. The first time was about a year and a half ago, and it was brought through a grant through our own public health department. And the workshop is put on by an organization out of Greensboro called the Racial Equity Institute. And it's two full days of intense history and how racism manifests itself. And when I talk about racism, I'm not really talking about specific behaviors or attitudes of individuals necessarily, but really the racism as it has existed throughout the history and even of our country and even before the country was started, how it's just been systemic. It's been systematized in our culture and in our laws, and I don't want to go. I don't really have time to go into it right now. But to say that I think that the monument is part of that history of systemic racism, and so I would invite this board. I know that There are other boards that have gone through this training. I know commissioners from Chatham County, from Wake County, from Orange County, from Durham County, even some in Guilford County who have gone through this. This Racial Equity Institute, you can go to their website. It's racialequityinstitute.org and learn more about the group. But they're invited to work with organizations and communities throughout the country. They just happen to be located in Greensboro. But they're very effective in opening up eyes and introducing a little bit different perspective about the whole subject of racism. There are going to be four more of these trainings in 2018 in Alamance County, and the places have yet to be determined, but and they're limited to 40 people for each session, and they try to make sure that there's close to 50% people of color in the sessions. But they're going to happen in January and April and August and November of 2018, and I'd invite everybody to go. Once you go to one, you're invited to go back. There is a cost, but there are also scholarships available. But I just think it's very valuable. So I'd like to respond to Mr. Creighton, Bob Creighton, who spoke last on the Cardinal Innovations Healthcare, because last week I attended the their Community Operations Board meeting for the five counties around us, the Orange Person, Chatham, plus Alamance and Caswell. And the issue of that, of the audits, were brought up at our meeting. Not a whole lot could be said because it's under litigation now through the judicial system. They're committed to continuing to provide services. The issue about the CEO or the agency spending unreasonable or exorbitant, as some would say, funds on the CEO and other management people there. They do point out that they really have two buckets of money to spend. One is for administrative purposes, and that's limited to 8% of the total budget, and one is for providing actual services to our population, so that's 93%. And even if you reduce the administrative funding, that the money that you reduce that by can't be used for the clinical services side. So I feel comfortable that while this is being adjudicated, that our citizens in Alamance County are going to get the services that they need. But we'll have to see how that case comes out. We're going to talk about more about the federal building, so I won't respond to Ms. Peterson. I appreciate Gary. I didn't quite catch your last name.
Joyce.
Pardon?
Barry Joyce.
Joyce, Mr. Joyce. I appreciate your comments, both on the statue and also on the Lucas machines. Being a former healthcare executive, I know what a difference that technology can make in saving lives, and so maybe that's something we can delve into. I don't know if we can take action tonight, but. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay.
Bill? No. I don't need to say anything.
Some days it's better. Though.
That's right. Some things is best left unsaid.
Yes.
I've heard about the Lucas machines from other volunteer fire department chiefs, and I know that I agree that that's an important issue, important consideration. And I am just really excited to see what happens with the sale of the Carnota building tonight. And whatever happens, I'm delighted to have had the opportunity to get to know more about the Alamance Academy, and your work is so impressive. And glad to hear about it. Thank you for coming out.
All right. With that, we will move on, and I'll ask for approval of our agenda for the evening.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Consent agenda, is there anything on there that you guys would like to pull out?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
All right, very good. Thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Now we're going to open the floor up for a public hearing on the radio financing project. you'll bring us up to date on that now.
Yes. Good evening, Commissioners. On September 18th, County Manager Brian Haygood presented an upcoming concern about the Emergency Services Radio Replacement Project. So on September the 27th, the Finance Department issued a request for proposal for the financing of this project. We requested financing of $3,019,810.10 to have options for 5, 6, and 7 year terms. The bids were opened on October 10th at 2 p.m. We had three banks that responded to the request for proposal, and those results were included in your packet. We received a bid from First Bank, BB&T, and Pinnacle. Looking at the bid results, BB&T came in with the lowest percentage rate of 2.16%, and we would want to go for the life of the radios for 7 years. What that will do is it will cover the cost of that life and then be ready for us to, at the end of those 7 years, to look at an additional purchase through the state contract. These radios are going to be purchased off of state contract through Motorola. And at this time, I would ask the board to enter into the public hearing, and then we'll have a couple of items to approve afterwards.
Okay.
I'm curious about the interest rate. You said it was
2.16%.
What would, just roughly 10 years ago, maybe the same offer, what would that have brought?
If I'm not mistaken, Mr. Sutton, that was at about 4.5%.
Double, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So the interest rate, we have seen those come down. We're also not having to borrow quite as much for this time because we are not purchasing radios for all of the fire departments, just for three, I believe, E.M. Holt, Northeast Alamance, and Snow Camp. And I provided in your packet what their cost annually would be, reimbursing the county.
Right. And I don't know if we want to read those or whatever.
So I have a question. There's when we decide on a capital purchase like this, mm-hmm. In my education, it's always two decisions, and they're not dependent on one another. They're kind of mutually exclusive decisions. One is the decision to make the purchase to begin with. Mm-hmm. And so I guess this is a real need that you've determined, yes. That you've budgeted for and all. And then the second decision, how to pay for it or how to finance it. And so there's choices. I mean, we could take it out of fund balance.
That's correct.
And save the 2.16% interest.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's... And really, on just a pure financial basis, if that 2.16% is less than what we value the cost of capital for this organization, so in other words, if we could make 5% on that fund balance, it would be better to finance it. But if we're only making 1% on the fund balance, maybe we ought to pay for it.
Exactly. And the way that we budgeted for this this current year was it was involved in our budget retreat. We addressed the need for purchasing radios, and we currently have in our budget $400,000 for that expense. Our first debt service payment would not happen until April, and that would be for $232,642.22. So that would cover in the first year.
So I am a believer in preserving our fund balance. So this helps. This method of financing will
yes.
do that, and I suppose that's
yes.
one of the reasons. The reason you decided to go this route.
Right. So what we would be looking for in next year's budget would be to find $65,280, around up $85. That would be for a full year's payment. Whereas this year, because of the timing of the installment loan, we would only have to have one payment. And we are covered right now.
And we will be being reimbursed by the fire departments that come in with us, so they will be we'll enter into an agreement with each department where they'll be told this is a dollar amount that you owe each year, and we'll receive that revenue
right.
from them. So we'll only be financing radios for county agencies.
Mm-hmm. And what the annual cost, and I'm sorry, I misspoke, the $465,000 is for the entire project. For the county's share, it would be $405,273.64. So we would only have to find a little over $5,000 to meet our debt service because we would have the revenue coming in from the fire districts.
Next fiscal year, we budgeted $400,000 for this fiscal year.
In this fiscal, 2017-18
yes.
year. Yeah.
That's a good interest rate.
Yeah.
It is. Okay, I guess I need a motion to go into public hearing.
I'll also move.
All right, thank you.
Second.
Mom. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And we'll just start on this side if there's anyone who would like to speak to this. Chair.
I just, you know, thinking about how Motorola seems like every two or three years they're changing things and you can't get parts for the old radios. I don't know if we've looked at leasing these radios, so when they do, we can trade in.
That's not a bad idea, sure.
And like I say, I don't know, but I know they change about every 4 or 5 years something,
yeah.
And we turn around and have to spend a bunch of money on radios. So I don't know if that's been checked into or if that's even a possibility. But yeah.
Brian, we did look at leasing options.
Right. We did look at a leasing option through Motorola, and the interest rate that we would have paid was greater than actually doing an installment loan.
Borrowing the money
when
to buy.
When we would own the radios and then look at a trade-in situation, which is what we're doing with our purchases this year.
When you lease, you're paying for that, you know, that shorter amount of time that you'll have them. They're worth much more. The last radios that we bought in mass, we bought in 2008. So we've gotten a significant amount of life out of the radios that we have now. So it does cost. These radios, during the term that we're paying on them, will be covered. Maintenance and repair will all be under warranty, and the maintenance is factored into the $405,000.
That's what I was going to ask. Because sometimes the lease, the maintenance is included in the lease, but not in just a financing arrangement. So that's like a loan.
This will include maintenance, warranty, and repair.
All right.
Barry, do you have?
Yeah, the only thing I would say is, you know, if revenue's coming back from the fire department, especially here in Holt, that they'll not be allowed to have a fire tax increase to pay this money back. You know, they seem to come up with things that need fire tax increases all the time. Just make sure that doesn't give them an excuse to raise the fire taxes to pay the money back.
All right.
I don't know that we can do that.
No, they're bored. People have to be there to fuss about that one.
At some point, we got to let citizens in these fire districts have a say-so.
Well, they have it. They have an opportunity.
They don't have any say-so.
Yeah.
They have no say-so. They can't even vote unless they're a member of a corporation. And, you know, at some point, it's going to happen. I mean, you know, the people in the Patrick's are going to get tired of it, and they're going to say, hey, man, we need to have a vote again. But they don't. They really don't have a vote. Mm-hmm.
All right. Anybody else on this side? If not, we'll move over here. Okay. All right. With that, I'll ask for a motion to close public hearing.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
So there are three items that I'm asking the board to approve tonight. The first is to award the radio financing project to BB&T at the term of 2.6% interest rate over the course of 7 years. There was a resolution prepared by our county attorney. I gave you an updated copy here. He just put a little bit more description concerning the project. The terms are from BB&T and have been reviewed by the county attorney.
That is a fixed rate.
Yes, sir.
It's 2.16, not 2.6.
Right, 2.16.
2.16%. On $3,019,810.
Yes, sir.
All right. I'll entertain a motion to move on that.
I'll make the motion. We'll accept that.
All right. Thank you, Bill.
A second.
Thank you.
Just one more question. Okay. So $3 million, I guess, in the grand scheme of our overall budget, is not real big, but is that going to affect our bond rating? I'm just thinking that we're going to have this, possibly having a big school bond, ACC bond, or whatever, coming up in the next year.
Actually, it's not, Commissioner Byrd. I was looking at the LGC application that we submitted with the Viper Radio project back in 2008. And our debt service at that point in time was about $89 million. On the application that I'm filling out today, our debt service at the end of 2018 would only be $50,408,087.
The debt service. Yeah. So what's our debt capacity?
Our debt capacity is 8% of our total assessed valuation. And that we are way below that. I think it's in the annual audit, so I can give you that final number, but it's like 100 and
our legal debt margin is $998,456,000.
Almost a billion.
Yeah. Okay. So we are well below our debt margin.
We have one of the lowest, not that I'm encouraging debt.
No, I understand.
At all.
We understand.
With that said, we have one of the lowest per capita debt service of 24 counties that we're in a group of.
And we want to keep it that way.
I think there's only two below us.
That's good financial management.
Sir?
That's good financial management.
I would say so. Good conservative commissioners.
It is, yeah. Well, you know, I'm a fiscally responsible progressive.
I'm just picking at you, Bob.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor of approving the financing on this? Say so by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed? All right.
All right, and then a motion to approve the resolution approving the financing terms.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Bill. Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
And then the last resolution that I need to have approved is the resolution that will authorize the county manager to file the application for the approval of the financing agreement as authorized by North Carolina Statute 160A-20.
So moved.
All right.
Second.
Thank you, Bill, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Very good.
Thank you.
Next, we will have another public hearing for some folks that are very interested in what we're going to do with our building on Graham Hopedale Road.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As you may recall, I asked the board to call a public hearing, which we set for tonight, to consider the private sale of the property to Alamance County Academy LLC. And Ms. Peterson has presented a glimpse of what her organization does. She also went into detail at our last meeting. She has agreed to provide office space to other nonprofits in the county, which frees up some of our office space. She's also agreed to let the county use some of that parking lot over there. What I've looked at the statutes, and I think the best way to do this is to advertise for sealed bids, like we did with the Opportunities for Everyone building several years ago. If you choose to proceed with the sale, I have prepared a resolution in your packet, which lays out the details of it. What I would do is put an ad in the paper to run Thursday, October 19th. The 30 days for opening sealed bids would end on November 20th, 2017. At that time, that evening, we would open the bids up at 12 noon that day, and that evening I could report to the board the result of the bids. And then you can choose to accept it, reject it, or again advertise for additional bids.
What's the square footage of that building?
Let's see.
Buddy's here. He probably knows.
A little over 30,000 square feet.
You know, Buddy? What?
I think it's 29,700 or something total.
Yes.
Upstairs.
29,777.
It was built in about six phases, though, starting in 1946. And therein lies the problem with the cost of the roof and the things that need to be done in the building. And Ms. Peterson's group, another part of the consideration she brings to the table is the good work she does in the community. But this lady here takes care of young people that no one else wants to take care of. So she does good work, from what I've heard, and Susan Osborne as well. So I'd ask the board to consider that resolution. And
So I have a question, and with all due respect to Ms. Peterson and her agency. There are other people that were interested in the building.
Yes.
And if we're going to have a process where we have sealed bids,
yes,
the way this is written, it seems like it's a foregone conclusion that we're going to sell it to the Alamance Academy, because the other parties who are interested aren't even mentioned in this resolution.
This resolution simply advertises it for sale. Anyone can bid on it.
Yeah, the resolution is just putting it out for anybody that does have an interest.
So are the other parties, and the one I'm thinking of in particular is Piedmont Health Services, are they still interested in the building?
I haven't heard from them. They came and walked through the building, and Mr. Weitzel.
They're still interested. They're going to come back Monday and look at it again.
So this just opens it up. So
it opens them up.
Anybody in the community that would like a building can put their bid in, and
that's correct. It just advertises to the world that it is going to be open for bid. Anyone can bid on it.
Okay.
Well, Mr. Burr's right. It's a little confusing because the resolution says Alamance County sale of real property to Alamance Academy LLC.
Yeah, that's kind of what.
And then the confusing language for the whereas is has to do with,
yes,
Alamance Academy.
Yes, the statute says that you have an offer and you present it to the board and then you advertise it for sealed bids. It's not a private sale.
But so what you're saying is that we already have that offer, so
right,
now we go through this process
through
to see if
Academy,
somebody else.
Okay. She's come forward with an offer. She's been in communication with me now for 3 months, I guess. Gotten to know her pretty well, and she's serious about this. And that's why I said, okay, I'll put it before the board.
But
anyone can bid on it.
And so she would have the financing and the wherewithal to do what needs to be done to the building and then have the ability to maintain the agency in perpetuity, as they say.
Yes, sir.
So, good.
And of course, the board makes the final decision.
Right. Yeah.
You may end up with six bids that you have to select. But, and then as part of that consideration, you take a look at the work she's already done in the community and make your decision.
And I'm only asking from a fiduciary responsibility perspective. I appreciate the services that you provide and much needed in our community.
Yes. Yeah.
So really, the only reason you put that name in, we could have had we could have said we're going to sell it, put it on the market,
right,
and similar to what we've done with Woody Drive.
But you have someone now that's serious about it. I haven't received a written offer from the other two. There are two parties, two other parties.
Okay.
But it's up to the board after the public hearing to decide whether you want to proceed.
How similar is this process in relation to the vocational rehabilitation or whatever we did?
O&E?
Yeah.
It's almost exactly.
That's what I thought.
They came to us. They were in the building. They were operating it. Roof was leaking. Air conditioning had failed. Heating had failed. And we were looking at a winter coming up. And the county didn't want to spend $500,000 on a roof. And they couldn't borrow the money on the building.
Right, because they didn't have ownership.
So that's what we did. Process and no one else bid on that, I might add.
Okay, so there is interest on this and all what you're asking. Well, we got a public hearing, so
right,
I guess we'll open the floor up again if I can get a motion to go in the public hearing.
So move.
All right. I second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, we'll start on this side. We'll change it up a little.
Hi, my name is Tammy Wyatt. I am one of the people with this peer support, the Alamance Academy.
Hi.
I have a very good peer support person. Alamance Academy has really brought me a long ways. They are really good people. And Mo, as she said, you know, she sticks by her word. And I just want y'all to know that she has really helped a lot of people, not only me, but other people in the community. And I really do think this would be best for her.
Very good.
Thank y'all.
Thank you. Anyone else on this side? Oh,
I'd just like to ask.
Everyone, this is my first time here.
Welcome.
And I want to speak on behalf of our organization. I got assigned to that committee, but it's a wonderful organization. I used to not talk to anyone, but it opened me up to not only show my artwork that I was blind 4 years ago, and God healed me, and I had over 500 paintings. So I just now put them in the paper. So last week I published another article, and it is a benefit. It helped me to open up to the public when I shut down after the death of my mother. So it is a great organization, great peer workers, and they really helped me. And I am a living testimony. It really helped me.
Thank you.
So it is a privilege to hear this. And I could have spoke on the other lady here, because I just was talking to my pastor in Ghana, and I asked him to take me to the door of no return. And I'm going to send her a video to let her see the whole thing of how it all started. Okay?
Very good. Cool.
Thank you. John.
Just a question, probably a Clyde question. Do the bidders have to be pre-qualified for the loan in order to do this? And if not, what happens with you guys if they can't get the financing?
Well, I'll let Clyde answer to that.
They put a bond down, 5% bond of their bid price. If they can't get the financing, they lose the bond, they lose the bid price. And we open it up for
a bid again.
Thank you.
Or go to the second bidder, I get. Second highest or something. Yes, Susan.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, so you'll know as you enter this process, how Alamance Academy interfaces with your local DSS. I think Mo has talked some about her level 2 group home, but they're doing amazing work with young folks in our community, getting them to college. If you ever have the opportunity to attend one of Mo's graduation nights, where every child that leaves her facility has a plan for their future, unlike living on the street or aging out of foster care without a plan. On the other side, our Work First area uses Mo. My staff, I ask them to write a few words. Community focused and passionate is how they describe Mo and the work. She works with substance abuse folks. If they don't have transportation, if they don't have Medicaid, most staff goes and picks them up, gets them where they need to go. She's hired some of our workforce participants herself as they have graduated from their peer support training. She is a solid community provider in our community and wants to grow and works collaboratively with your social services.
Susan and Mo, just for education on the money flow, can you tell a little bit where the money comes from to keep the operation going? And
I'm contract with Cardinal Innovations,
right,
and also Alliance in Sand Hill, so I'm a Medicaid provider.
Okay, all right.
And so for level 2 group care, she gets a rate from Medicaid,
right,
per night for the folks, and she keeps, as she mentioned, she's contracted with 3 catchment areas, so she doesn't have all Alamance County kids,
right,
in her,
right,
group home.
Okay. Anyone else? All right, I'll ask for a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
All right, thanks, Bill. Thanks, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Now I guess we need to vote on or put it up, see what the will of the board is to follow through with our resolution to put it on the market.
I move that we follow the process as outlined by our attorney.
Okay. I'll second that.
All right, thank you, Bob, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Very good. Next on our agenda tonight, we have the library, Ms. MJ Wilkinson.
Good evening, County Commissioners.
If I'm a friend of the library, I have to sign.
No, you get to sign that as the chair of the County Commissioners. This week, starting this yesterday, is National Friends of the Library Week, and we want to recognize the importance that our friends play in the success of the library programs and the services that the library offers. We have a statewide recognized program, the Zoom Pass program, that they we could not do without them, and it's been recognized with a state award. And so we have a proclamation, if you want to read it, to I announce that
it
is national.
I'll let you read it since you...
She knows how to read, too.
She knows how to read better than I do.
Whereas Friends of the Alamance County Public Library raise money that enables our library to move from good to great, providing the resources for additional programming, much-needed equipment, support for children's summer reading, and special events throughout the year. And whereas the work of the Friends highlights on an ongoing basis the fact that our library is the cornerstone of the community, providing opportunities for all to engage in the joy of lifelong learning and connect with the thoughts and ideas of others from ages past to the present. And whereas the Friends understand the critical importance of well-funded libraries and advocate to ensure that our library gets the resources it needs to provide a wide variety of services to all ages, including access to print and electronic materials, along with expert assistance in research, reader's advisory, and children's services. And whereas the Friends' gift of their time and commitment to the library sets an example for all in how volunteerism leads to positive civic engagement and the betterment of our community. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Alamance County Commissioners proclaim October 15th through the 21st, 2017, as Friends of the Library Week in Alamance County, and urges everyone to recognize the Friends of Alamance County Public Libraries and thank them for all they do to make our public libraries and community so much better.
Very good. I want to mention last week I went on the tour of the graveyard that our library sponsored and put on, and they're actually going to Mebane tomorrow night, I think.
Tomorrow is Mebane, and then it's next Tuesday is Graham. They
went
are
to Pine
they've been
Hill,
highly
they talk
successful.
To different folks that are laid to rest there, and there's a horse there that I didn't realize.
Horse.
From the Civil War, yes.
They do. The staff does a fine job of doing those, keeping the respect of being in a cemetery, but telling some interesting stories.
That's fine.
Glad you enjoyed it.
It was interesting.
Thank you.
All right. Next, Ray, if you will bring us up to date on the stretcher and Lucas device.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I've just got a brief presentation to share with you tonight. So basically tonight, I just want to do just kind of an overview of our EMS system, kind of how we're structured, and then talk about some of our recent statistics and call volumes, and then get into the lease request. So basically, Alamance County EMS provides all paramedic level service to the citizens and visitors of Alamance County, as well as providing all non-emergency ambulance transportation in Alamance County. So someone's in a nursing home, needs to get to a doctor's appointment, or is stretcher bound, needs to get home from the hospital. We do that, as well as responding to all 911 requests for anybody that calls for an ambulance. And then we triage and transport patients to hospitals in Alamance as our primary transport location, but we also go into Guilford County to Moses Calm, Durham to Duke and Duke Regional and the VA, and then Orange County we transport to Chapel Hill. For those folks that need that. So the way we're structured is we operate 8 24-hour paramedic level ambulances. Three of those are stationed on East Crescent, Square Drive, and Graham. Three are on Boone Station in West Burlington, and then two are on North Graham Hopedale Road in East Burlington. And we're going to be adding an additional 12-hour peak ambulance. It's going to be operating approximately noon to midnight. That was budgeted for this year, and we hope to add that in January. In addition, to help with the non-emergency and the convalescent calls, we do staff two non-emergency ambulances Monday through Friday from the hours of about 9 to 7. And then for the outlying areas in the community, so we can get rapid paramedic level care to those folks, we operate what we call medic trucks, and these have a senior paramedic in a pickup truck that has all of our paramedic level gear, and we have one of those in Mebane, one at Altamaha Hospice Fire, and then one at the southern base of Alamance Rescue on Belmont Mount Hermon Road. So, and of course, our responses are augmented by local fire departments, law enforcement, and Alamance Rescue. We wouldn't be able to do it without our first responders, because they're able to get there a lot quicker than us sometimes and get that valuable life-saving aid going. And then Alamance County Rescue also helps us a lot. When we run out of ambulances, we'll ask them to come on standby and they'll provide an ambulance, and then we'll have one of our medic trucks make those folks paramedic level when needed. So just an overview of our call volume. You can see the last 4 years here. With the current year being in blue, and you can see we've had consistent growth most months, with 2017 being more so. So we're growing some of the first months of the year a bit anomalous there, but you know, the consistent trend is we're getting busier and busier.
That because we're getting older and older?
Talk about
yourself. You have to be determined.
Yeah, speak for yourself.
And then I just wanted to point out the hourly call distribution. You see we get a little bit slower during the night, but we really get busy during the day. So we're really trying to target those peak hours to add ambulances to try to be as efficient as we possibly can. And then some of our call locations, just to kind of show why all of our ambulances are based in the greater Burlington Graham area.
Forgive me, I was offering some water.
You see our call distribution. There's lots of little dots on this map out in the outer parts of the county that show our call volume, and you can see that on this heat map how we really are busy in that greater Burlington Graham and the ever-growing Mebane area, which is why we have our ambulance currently located the way they are, all being in town. Just a review of some of our statistics. Our shoot times being about a minute and 24 seconds on average, so that's from the time the ambulance gets the call to the time they check in route, we're averaging a minute and 24 seconds. Response times, that's the call received, so whenever the call is received in CCOM and they start processing it to the time we get a unit on scene makes up our response time. So anytime it takes CCOM to process and then it takes us to get in our vehicles and check in route, and then the drive time there all makes up those components. So we try to watch all of those and keep those trimmed as we can. Our average response time is 12 minutes and 50 seconds, and 90% of the time we get on scene in under 20 minutes. Obviously for some of those outlying locations it takes a little bit longer and we're a little bit quicker in the more populated areas. Average turnaround time when a unit gets to the hospital, it takes them about 23 minutes to get back in service. For the next call, we watch that because we want to make sure that they're getting out just as quickly as they possibly can. And then a workload measure that we use in EMS called unit hour utilization. And that measures the time that we're between dispatched and in service on a call. And we're on calls about 38% of the time. So this does not include paperwork. It doesn't include driving back from the hospital. It doesn't include washing the trucks, checking them off, and any of those other things. That's just 38% of our day we're between dispatched and in service on a call. So we're very, very busy.
Would you go to line two again, response times, and then go over that whole thing one time more?
Yes, sir. So we measure response times from the time the call rings in the center,
right,
downstairs, to the time we get on scene. So you really have three major segments there. You have that call processing time, then you have our ambulance shoot time, how long it takes us to get to the truck, and then you have the time it takes us to actually drive to get on scene. So that puts us averaging 12 minutes and 50 seconds. And then I've got a slide coming up that kind of shows how we compare against the rest of the state.
All right. Again, 12:50 to get define that
site. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, it takes 12 minutes and 50 seconds on average for us to arrive from the time they actually pick up the phone and call 911.
And what's the under 2013 that you've got there?
That's our 90th percentile. So 90% of our calls were there in under 20 minutes.
That doesn't seem to compute. It seems like
I can see
why you're asking. So the average is under 13 seconds, but the 90th percentile is under
20 minutes,
but 90 percentile is under 20.
Correct. So we have a lot of really short, really, really short times. Mm-hmm. And then we have a real lot of, you know, longer response time, so that averages down to that 12-minute mark. But 90% of the time, we're there in under
12.5.
In under 20 minutes.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Is that making any sense?
Still doesn't feel intuitive.
No, I'm confused.
So that's our 90.
I don't believe you.
You know, 90% of the time, we're under that minute, and then or under that 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. And then 10% of the time, we're above.
You have a math there,
right? Yeah.
Well, do you feel that's the industry norm as far as, and I'm not saying nobody's efficient or not efficient or that they are or not, but is that the industry norm, you think, for a county our size with our population and so forth and so on?
We're pretty close. Let me see where I've got that. Here it is. So this is looking at, this is a state produced graph that shows our average response time over on the left compared to the state average. And then other urban groups. So Alamance County is classified as an urban EMS system. So there you can see we're just at about that 13 and a half minute mark on this graph. And the state average for the urban groups is just under 14 minutes. So we're doing pretty well holding our own. But we've still got some more work to do. Getting that ninth truck on the road is going to help start to bring down some of these response times. And as we add resources in the future, that'll help as well.
So what would that 90th percentile comparison look like?
I did not put that graph in there, but we were pretty close to the urban.
Close to the urban on that
yes,
side.
Yes, sir. Yeah. And that 90th percentile is just an automatically computed number in our call software that we use. We enter in all of our times, all of our call data, and it automatically generates that 90th percentile number.
Maybe we're interpreting that 90th percentile wrong, because maybe it's like the 100th. If you had the 100th, that would be the longest call.
Correct. And then 90% of the time, we're below that 20 minutes.
Well, I would hope so.
I don't mean to be funny there.
But if you're close to a station, you're going to be less than 12.5.
Yeah, right. Oh, yeah.
So yeah.
It takes time to drive, obviously. Yeah.
And, you know, like I said, we look from the time the phone rings. We don't just look at our drive time. We look at from the time the phone rings in CECOM. Because if you're calling 911, it really doesn't matter to you how long it took to drive versus how long it took them to do their stuff. So we look at that entire segment. When we measure. Since we're coming to ask for this lease, I did want to talk about our revenue and just to show the efforts that we've made. You can see where we were back in October of last year. This is what we're budgeted to do each month, and we raised our revenue goal for this year. So we raised it to about 370. And you can see that we're consistently over target. July was a little under, but we were over both in August and September. And we envision with some of the steps that we've taken that we'll continue to see those revenue numbers grow. But I did just want to show that consistency.
While you're on that revenue, have our collections gotten better? Or I know we had an issue one time with collections and people were having trouble with getting the right people to talk to.
Yes, sir. Yeah, we've worked very hard on that. You know, we have a billing liaison in our office now that's our sole focus is tracking the numbers and being the kind of that voice and gram for people that need to come by that have issues.
Yeah.
So we've worked very hard on that. And then I did want to go on an overview of our equipment request. So I kind of wanted to talk about what they were before I asked for them. So we are asking for nine striker power load systems and stretchers. And you can see there, that's our newest truck in Graham, has one. We currently have six on the road that we've bought in the past. And you can see how the stretcher just looks like it's holding itself out there. These systems will lift patients of upwards of 700 pounds. So the stretchers lift them up from the ground, and then we click them. You can't really see it well on the picture, but we click them into some antlers in the truck and press a button, and arms come up, grab the stretcher, the carriage comes up, and then we just push it in. So there's no lifting involved whatsoever. So it significantly reduces injury risk to patients and personnel because it reduces the risk that we're going to miss something and accidentally drop and hurt somebody, as well as it prevents back injuries for our folks. And it also seems to significantly reduce employee fatigue and increases morale, which is very important as well. And then our Lucas devices, and that's what they look like. We are requesting three. We currently have one in service, and that's on our supervisor truck that stays in Graham. We want to put these three on our medic units with our senior paramedics and respond one of these to every cardiac arrest in the county. Like's been said, they do increase the consistency in compressions. You know, once you put them on there, push the button, it compresses 102 beats per minute. It never gets tired. It never wavers. You never have to pause to switch out. And then it decreases the number of personnel needed on cardiac arrest calls. That's not to say that we don't still need our first responders to get there and get CPR going very quickly. But it does help to prevent us from having to send more than one ambulance and a quick response vehicle on a call. There are some in some areas where sometimes we have to send two ambulances now just because there may not be enough fire personnel to help us out at that given moment, depending on what other call volume's going on. So these really help. And then you can see in that picture someone actually being transported from to the hospital with it going, and it's still doing perfect compressions, which is very hard for a human to do in a moving ambulance. So kind of the brass tacks of the request. We are requesting the Board of Commissioners to approve a four-year combined lease for Stryker Power Stretcher Systems and Physio Lucas Compression Devices. Both are owned by Stryker, so that's why we're asking for a joint lease. There are some further pending legal matters to be worked out by our attorney before the approval, so it would be approval pending the legalities being worked out. We're additionally requesting that Stryker be named a sole source vendor. As I said earlier, we have six of those currently in place, so it helps to keep consistency on all of our units. And then Stryker is the only one that makes this particular kind. Furno has one out there, a power stretcher, but it operates totally differently, and it would be extremely confusing for our staff to be switching back and forth. And we've had really good service out of the Stryker so far. The total annual cost is $110,509.96. You can see the breakdown between the stretcher cost and the Lucas for a total cost of $442,039.84, with the total cost of the stretchers being $384,528 and the Lucas being $57,510. And the annual cost of both of these were approved in our 2017-18 budgets. And with that, I'll be happy to entertain any questions that you all may have.
I have a question. Well, a couple of questions. So the total cost being $442,000, when I looked at the agreement, it didn't look like a lease. It looked more like a loan. It's a finance. We own the equipment. It's not like they own it and they're leasing it to us. We own the equipment.
Right. So it's a lease with a $1 purchase at the end.
Okay, I didn't see that in the agreement. So my question was, what if we just bought it outright? What would the cost be? And I guess that's another way of asking, what's the imputed interest rate that we're incurring as a result of paying for this over, it's really over a three-year period, not a four-year period, because the first payment's right up front.
Right.
It's four payments. And I would ask the same question as I asked at the last for the last purchase: is it better to finance it or just to take it out of fund balance and just pay for it?
Ray, the purchase of one of those strikers, or for two of them, was for $75,000, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So to purchase them straight out, nine would be around $300,000. Mm-hmm. And then to purchase the Lucas, you're looking at an additional $54,816.
So on the, just the stretchers, we'd be paying like roughly $84,000 just in interest over the 3 years.
Pretty high interest rate, isn't it?
Now, there might be other advantages of quote leasing if it includes a service arrangement that wouldn't be included if you purchased them outright for that amount, but.
Yes, it would result in the interest of $84,000.
Again, the benefit is, you know, we go through this whenever we're trying to figure out the best deal to bring to the board. Traditionally, we've tried to stay away from committing too much fund balance. I know we've committed more fund balance this year in our budget than we have in a very long time.
That's a good point.
And we're looking at some expenses coming up next fiscal year, I think for animal shelter, that are pretty large. So it's, those are things to bear in mind as you make these decisions. We can stretch this out over a couple of years. We will pay interest, but we stay out of fund balance. Or you can pay for it up front, avoid the interest cost, but we are getting into our fund balance. I would caution you that you know, we have committed a lot this year in 17-18. We will more than likely spend fund balance this year and are looking at some big expenses in 18-19 that will take fund balance to do.
Well, those are good points.
And you said that this was allocated for in our budget
yes,
for this year?
Yes,
so
ma'am.
The money's already been set aside for it?
Yes, ma'am.
I got a question. Now, does this bid on a state contract, I know it's a lease, but how does that work? Help me out with that.
So the physio part is on a state contract, but the striker, because they're a sole source vendor, is not. So for the stretchers, they are not on any of the contracts, and that's part of the request tonight, is to have them designated as a sole source vendor. They are the only vendor out there that produces this type, and then we have six already in service. So in order to keep the consistency, which is all part of that.
So is that part of the legality that we need to?
Yes, we're asking you to approve buying from Stryker since they're the only one that makes the same kind that we already have. And I think what Ray's trying to avoid is having to train his folks on how to operate different systems. If they can all know just the Stryker, but we have to have your permission to do that. The board has to say it's okay to only buy Stryker stretchers.
I think that's important. You don't want need people to be trained on one and not trained on the other, and you got to cross train them. It's a headache, big headache.
It is, and it equals a lot of risk for patients. Yeah. You know, and if a wrong button's pushed at the wrong time.
I guess
time.
The main question is the legality of it.
Everything be the same.
It's okay then.
If the board approves this as a sole source, then it's legal. We can do it. It's fine. But it is an option you can do, and we would hope that you would consider that to keep it simple for staff, and I think the Stryker folks are making a product that does the things that Ray and EMS need for it to do too.
Yes. All right, now on the Lucas, is that an acid Lucas?
Yes, sir.
All right, we've only got one, right? Is that
correct.
What you're saying? Okay, how long have we had that one?
We got that one about last October.
All right, how many times has it been used that you know of?
I don't have that number, but it's probably used, you know, five or six times a week. The supervisor can't respond to every cardiac arrest in Alamance County, but they stay busy getting it out to folks.
Okay, in a not necessarily a perfect world, but I'd rather have my druthers world. What would be maybe not the ultimate, but better than just having four?
I mean, ideally, if we had them on every response vehicle that we had, you know, every ambulance and all of our medic units, that would be ideal. Because if a medic unit is on another call, then it's not going to be available to where if you had one on every. But I feel like, at least initially, unless the board wants to go otherwise, that we'll be able to get them to most cardiac arrest calls, but I can't guarantee a response to every one. Just because, like I said, a medic unit could be tied up on another call in their district when the cardiac arrest came out.
How many more would you need?
Well, we'll have 9 paramedic level units from January, so we have 8 now. So we would need 9 more to get them on every vehicle that we have.
9 in addition to what you're requesting?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And to Mr. Joyce's point about the volunteer fire departments, that you need a lot more. We have a lot of volunteer fire departments, I think, right?
Yes, sir. So if
you know, if that was the structure, then you would want one at each. But I will say that there are efficiency issues with using them. So you want part of the reason that I really like the medic unit structure that we have going now is that we'll have senior folks deploying these. And that's not to say that everybody can't be trained on them and everybody can't get proficient, but the fewer people that you have using them, the more proficient they'll be. Because one of the pitfalls of these automatic compression devices is deployment time once it gets there. So if you halt compressions because you're focused on getting this going, then by the time you get it going, you've totally negated its function. And you know, so that's part of the pitfall. And again, I'm not making the implication that we couldn't train everybody and get everybody proficient.
Right. But at least initially. High volumes is necessary to maintain proficiency. I mean, that's pretty standard in healthcare.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I do appreciate the stretcher issue with trying to prevent injury, especially to the personnel. I don't know how many nurses I know who have blown out their backs transferring patients, and I can imagine that for you all it would be a very difficult thing, especially as Americans. We're told way more and more, personal company accepted, I'm sure. But yeah, I can see how being able to mechanically lift folks into the transport would be an important
thing
to protect your people.
Yes, ma'am.
Long term, so that they're not 65 years old and having constant back surgeries.
Yes, ma'am. Yep.
Which saves the county money.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Since we are self-insured.
Well, I'm in favor of approving. I might just go ahead and make the motion to approve what's being recommended. But I'd also add that we just look ahead in future budgets just to evaluate the need to have more Lucas.
And that's definitely something we want to do. Once we get these deployed, we want to track how long it takes us to respond these to our cardiac arrest calls and to measure the survival rates and to see if it's going to be necessary to expand our program. But we feel like this is a sound place to start, but it may not be where the program needs to be ultimately.
Yeah. I like that approach because you don't need to buy equipment just to buy equipment.
Right.
Make sure that it's being used in the right way. That makes sense.
Track. I'll second your motion, Bob.
All right. All right. Well, we have a motion and a second. Any more questions? All right. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? None heard? Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you.
Can I ask a question? A legal question? If you guys, county attorney here, if you just put these things in certain areas, are you entering yourself into a legal liability by providing better service in one area than you are in another area?
I'm not an attorney, so I'm going to let our attorney answer that.
You've got volunteer firemen that are much closer than the EMS. They're usually the first ones on the scene anyway.
What I'm saying is
they're your human Lucas device, and they'll save lives.
But what I'm saying is if I don't have the service of a Lucas machine because I don't live close to one, okay, are you putting the county in a legal liability situation where I could come back and say you are showing favoritism or I paid the same tax rate as this guy did? Are you putting yourself in a legal situation?
We have this thing called sovereign immunity.
Yeah.
I don't care. You get sued all the time. You lose all the time. But anyway.
All right. That's, okay. To answer your question, Barry, we have one now. So, and
I
we
know,
don't know
really
where that truck is.
Put yourself in a legal liability situation there.
So we're going to put it hopefully in closer proximity for you.
I think it's a fair question. Yeah. In my healthcare experience, we would call that standard of care. Are we going to be providing the same standard of care throughout the whole community?
And the answer to that is that's why we have volunteer firemen.
Right.
And these are people in the community that are volunteering and training and taking CPR courses and maintaining the certification.
First one
and that may be the standard of care, given where the technology is and the ability to have it everywhere.
But the firemen are the one that are asking for.
Well, we'll consider that maybe in our next budget cycle. Because these were already budgeted. All right. Very good. Brian Baker, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners. Here on behalf of the Recreation and Parks Commission to seek approval of a contract to do some grading on Saxbaugh Island. We are in the midst of building our park there. This will allow us to grade some of the pedestrian areas and the parking area. So this is a bid. We took three bids on this project. This one came to $52,730. These funds are coming entirely from a grant from the North Carolina Recreational Trails Program. So there's no county funds at issue. We're just over the contract amount, so I need approval to get this work done.
Any questions? I'll make a motion that we approve it then.
I'll second it, but I'd like to ask a question. Do we ever consider whether or not contractors and people we do business with are minority owned or not?
We do. We have a threshold of purchasing level that we have to consider that. I think we have a policy about that at the dollar threshold that this is. I'm not 100% sure about that. I can get that answer to you. But I know we do when we reach a certain level of formal bidding, if we have to do minority-owned business solicitation.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Have a motion and a second. Any more questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No objection. Thank you, sir. Criminal court chiller replacement. Brian.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, so I'm here this evening to ask you to allocate money from fund balance. This is one of those unforeseen issues. We did know that the chiller at criminal court was in bad shape. It's over 20 years old. It's at the end of its useful life. But what I'm asking for tonight is you consider approving up to $120,000 to come from the county's fund balance to replace this unit. Originally, we had the replacement of the chiller in our capital improvement plan, but it has recently experienced a breakdown and has forced us to have to move it up to me being here tonight asking for it to be replaced now. The chiller had a compressor that failed, and it's currently operating at half capacity. This is the third compressor we've had fail in approximately 5 years. We could replace the compressor. The compressor costs about $15,000 to replace, but we are at the end of the life of this chiller unit, and we estimate the chiller will take $120,000 to replace. However, if we do it, we should be looking at another 20 years of life out of a new chiller. If we do it this time of year, we can avoid the extra cost that would come with having to rent like a portable chiller unit to come in to keep the court cool. Plus, we would be able to plan the work. If we wait till it breaks, it will guarantee break at a terrible time with some awful trial going on, and it'll be a real disaster. So, aside from the fact that I am asking for $120,000 to come from fund balance, we do feel like this would be the best way to go. Just for your knowledge, talking with Susan, our current fund balance, this is an estimate. We haven't received our audit for 16-17 yet, but we are estimating our current fund balance to be over $37 million, which is 26% of fiscal year 16-17 expenses. So while I am recommending to you to be careful with fund balance, I do feel like this is a reasonable thing. And it is not budgeted, so this is a good reason to consider using
it. Well, we have fund balance.
I'm sorry.
Well, and our policy is for 25%.
That's correct.
So we could, we'll probably still be above that. Yeah. And we'll still probably be in good shape at the end of the year, even though what you just said a little while ago is that we're going to be dipping into probably a little bit in the fund balance just to maintain our operations for the year.
That's correct.
What percentage is that?
Estimated 26%. We haven't received the audit for 16-17, but just looking over the numbers that we have from 16-17, unaudited, we should be at 26%.
Well, I mean, that's 20-year-old. I don't even know what can they get the Freon to charge it up when they get it.
Well,
get the compressor
get it,
in
it's
it.
It's like $900 a.
Right. I mean, it's very expensive to keep them up once you do that because they've changed all that. So.
I suppose a new compressor will be more energy efficient than what we have.
New chiller.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, a chiller, right?
Yes.
Well, I'll make a motion that we approve the request.
I'll second that.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. Any more questions? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none. Thank you, sir. All right. Next, we have our county manager.
So this request is my recommendation to the board. I'm asking that the commissioners consider creating a new fire inspector position in the fire marshal's office to be effective December 1, 2017. This would be using funds inside the current fire marshal's office budget. This would not take any new funding from fund balance. So what we have going on, we have a position that is currently in the fire marshal's office, full-time position. It is a chemical planner position. This position is actually paid for 100% by funds from the local emergency planning committee. This is a funding that comes from local industries to help pay for staff to be able to work with them to help them plan how to properly store chemicals they keep on their properties, and also how to work with industry to do plans in the event something should happen on their properties. So that's the main job of the chemical planner. It has been traditionally housed in the fire marshal's office. The local emergency planning committee has in the past allowed this position to also help with fire inspections. So we were using this person to do planning with industry and fire inspections. Industry chemical regulations have changed. And in talking with the LEPC, this position needs to spend all of its time now working with our industry in Alamance County, helping them properly plan for how to react to some incident on their property, and also to help them understand how industry has changed. That's this position's real function. However, if we make that change, which we are going to make that change, that means this person would no longer be able to assist with fire inspections, which will leave the fire marshal's office short for help with fire inspections, investigations, and being on call, because fire marshal's office is also on call. So what I'm proposing to do is to take funds that are currently in the fire marshal's office budget in this year and create a new full-time position of fire inspector. We do have part-time monies in the fire marshal's office right now. They have used part-time in the past. I'm recommending to use all those part-time funds toward the new position, so there would no longer be any part-time monies available. It would all be in the new position. And then we would also use other funding in the fire marshal's office budget that had been set aside for radio templates and maintenance that they no longer need. They're not going to need this year. The new fire inspector position would have a salary of $43,000 and would start December 1st, 2017. It is important to understand that while we won't need new money to do it this year, this would become a position that would recur. So it would be something that we would incorporate into the budget next year. But I do feel like this is a good opportunity. The chemical planner position is empty right now. The person that had that position moved up when we had some turnover. So we're at a point where we need to hire for this position. And there's a difference between hiring somebody that can work with industry and do chemical planning as opposed to do fire inspector. It would help us clarify who we hire. So the timing is right. The position is vacant. We can do it without any new money. And I think it would be a good move. The chemical planner position would move to emergency management. So we have another LAPC funded position that's in emergency management now. This would be a natural fit. It needs to go over to emergency management. So bottom line, I'm asking to be able to rearrange the fire marshal's funds to make this happen. I'd be happy to answer any questions, and I'm sure Johnny Payne can answer any questions too.
Well, you mentioned that it would be a recurring position, so it wouldn't affect the budget this year, but it might next year. But it wouldn't unless you added back those part-time positions.
That's correct.
And whatever other unspent money that you're using this year, if you added those in the next year's budget too. So you could do it without adding any more incremental expense to the overall budget.
Yes, that is correct.
Okay.
Does the city have chemical planners?
No, this is for the whole county.
Okay, so you cover all municipality and... Yes, sir. So the more we gain industry, the more we need this too.
I'll make a motion, we accept it.
Okay. Questions?
I'll second it.
All right.
We do know that there are a lot of chemicals out there.
Yeah, there are a lot of chemicals out in there.
Disaster planning is very important.
We're very grateful too for the LAPC for funding both of these positions, and they have been very supportive of the fire marshal's office and emergency management too. So.
Have a motion, second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
Next, we'll have Buddy Weitzel, sir. Make your report on the Woody Drive building.
Good evening, Commissioners. I come before you to ask for y'all to approve a contract with D.H. Griffin Wrecking for to demolish 779 Woody Drive, the old Peak Resources. This contract is for $79,685, which was approved in the July 17th board meeting of $178,000 through demolishment of Peak and the training center and the abatement of these buildings. So we would be just asking for a portion of that $178,000 to demolish Peak.
D.H. Griffin has done a lot of the work for us in the past.
And we received seven bids on this job, and they were lowest. They ranged from $249,000 to $79,000.
Big variance.
Any questions?
All right. Entertain a motion to move forward with that.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Amy.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. We need a library budget revision for North Park Library. You back.
This time with numbers, and they're not going to be decimal numbers.
No card catalogs.
That's right. After we had gone through the budget process and the budget had been approved, I received word from Sonia Randolph for the City of Burlington, who heads up the Community Development Block Grant allocations, that they were cutting the amount of funding that they usually afford North Park out of the Community Development Block Grant. Traditionally, that's been $10,000 this year, and they were having to make cuts because there were federal cuts that were made on a federal level, and so we were at the bottom of their list of for who was going to get those cuts. We were top of their list, I guess. So we actually they cut our funding by $2,169. And we have we did this anyway. We looked at our budget and how we wanted to spread that allocation out. And so what you have before you is how that $7,931 would be allocated for use at North Park. If you have any questions about any of that, I'll be happy to answer.
Well, it's too bad that you had to be put in that position to have to reduce for that particular location, but
she assured me that we would not be at the bottom of the list next year, that somebody else would take the cuts next year rather than us. So, and to be fair, in 2014-15, they had extra funding and they gave us $4,000 extra. So it washes out.
Well, as the commissioner that serves on the MJ's advisory board, I'll go ahead and make the motion to approve the request.
A second.
Okay. Any questions for MJ? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none. Thank you. All right. Very good. County manager's report.
I have no report. One thing I would like to take this opportunity to say publicly is how much we have appreciated the tax department's revalue. They did a great job. We're through the first quarter of 17-18, and it has been they just did a great job, and wanted to recognize them publicly and say that we have, all the departments, all of county government appreciates the hard work they did.
Okay. All right. Any commissioner comments?
Yeah, I got a couple belated ones, but are these Lucas distributions going to be demographically driven as far as population, where you're putting them, and so forth?
Well, we'll have our supervisor that will respond in the greater Burlington and Graham areas, and then we're going to be putting them in our medic unit districts in Mebane, one up north in the Altamaha area, and then one down south.
They are spread
rescue slot. Right. So what we're going to do is we're going to respond those while the ambulance going. They'll also, and to reiterate what Mr. Albright said, you know, our reliance is still on the first responders to get there and get that, you know, hands-only CPR going very quickly. That's a very effective method. But then when the Lucas gets there, then that really saves a lot of labor getting it on there. So, you know, our effort is to get them on every cardiac arrest every time, but we're still going to be focusing on making sure that everybody's very proficient with their compressions.
Another thing, I agree with Bob. I don't think there's any question that we're going to have to address this at budget time for more.
technically. Second point is I would like to request that we get a comparison, not that I want to do what everybody's doing or not doing, but, you know, we talk about our fund balance, you know, the policy and so forth. I think back years, when I was last on the board before I went off, I think Manning was our finance officer, and he was telling us that our fund balance would be at 16%. And it's just, in my opinion, it's exploded. And at what level is it too high? And, you know, we had taxes raised 5 cents with the biggest portion of the distribution of that going to employee salaries was my understanding, and the rest of it went fund balance, is my understanding. And what I would like to see is look at, there's, we're in a group of 24 counties based on population. I think you got your mega counties, and then you've got us in a group of about 24. State Treasurer's Office has this, and I think they could probably, we could figure out what percentages counties are at with our fund balance. And I like to see that myself. Whether, again, just because one county's at 25 doesn't mean we got to be at 25. You know, it's
look at all of them.
Yeah, I think you'd be surprised at how low some of them are percentile wise, and they're progressive counties. A lot of the counties' fund balances are well, it's like Davidson. We went down to Davidson. You and I went down. That's how we talked about the
performance
management budgeting process. But if you remember when we were down there, we asked a question, I did, about them not lowering their tax rate at reevaluation. And he made some reference, that's why their fund balance had gotten up so high. And I said, well, they'd burn our courthouse down. We tried that. But so I'd like to see that comparison. Now, third point. You mentioned the dog pound, the dog scenario. Can we get a report on where we're at with that, what our obligations are, what we've committed to, and is there, I mean, that was approved by a previous board.
Yes.
And I'd like to see the, because I have a lot of people ask me about it. You know, what are
I
you doing?
I agree, Tim.
Yeah.
We definitely need to look at that.
Do we?
Well, nothing's been done yet.
Yeah, it's true. And to hear that we're going to have to go in fund balance, take care of that, you know, when on a project it may be excessive, to say the least. I'd like to see what we got pending for that.
Sir.
And fourthly, I don't really want to open up a can of worms, but, you know, the Burlington, Alamance Burlington School System is wanting to change their name. Bob, you're at all their meetings. And
Amy is too.
Yeah. You going, are you still going to them?
Yes, I am.
We're both attending them all.
I didn't see you throw your hand.
What it's going to cost to do it.
Well, they addressed it at the last meeting very little. Just
I don't believe that. You got to change every piece of paper that's got their name on it. You got to do everything.
Well, the way they explained, they wouldn't do that all at once. They would do it
yeah,
as they would normally.
Yeah, but it still costs money. Yeah. It's going to cost money to do it.
Amy,
I think it's stupid to do
well,
it.
Well, there's some positioning going on, and I believe it's a political motivation, and I have a problem with possibly somebody wanting to change the name who's not going to be here next year to start with. Burlington City Council is going to take this up tomorrow night, and it's my understanding that the majority of that board is opposed to the name change. And I have a problem with it because, in all honesty, I think Burlington, you know, I love Alamance County, but Burlington seems to add some, for the lack of better words, clout to the recognition of the system for good or bad reasons. But the legality of changing the name, I wish Clyde would address this. I had all of you, I've got a copy passed out to everybody about our school merger plan. And I wasn't on our board when this was approved, but I was there when they were discussing all this, and then I did get on
yeah.
the board.
Okay. That may have stole yours.
But the school merger plan clearly stated, it was one paragraph, said that if the county commissioners merged the school system, in other words, if the school systems merged themselves, they can negotiate everything they want. Name, makeup of the board, you name it. You just had to and even funding, per pupil funding. They could call all the shots. But if the commissioners merged the board, the only prerequisite was that you had to take the school system, the new one, to the highest level of the per pupil funding of the two or three, which in this case is two systems, and Burlington was the highest of the two as far as per pupil.
That's exactly the way it was.
So, in all honesty, it was going to cost about $4 million to eventually pull the two together over a course of years, but a total inclusion of $4 million. Okay. They clearly were not to name themselves. And there were minutes of meetings on this board here. I think Ricky Moorfield was here, Larry Sharp, Frank Bennett, Kerry Allred, and I believe Junior T. There were clearly negotiations that were kicked back into their lap for them to talk it out to where everybody would be happy. But the county commissioners technically named that system. By the resolution, they technically named it. It says in here that the system will be named this, the school board will be named this. And it's my belief that, you know, to how are they going to legally get by this if they name themselves, change their names themselves? Don't they have to either get our approval to go against what the merger plan was or get the state legislature to overrule or... Because there's no sunshine laws on this, I wouldn't think.
Well, the only statute I've found on that is every retirement 67. And it talks about how school systems are merged, and the merger plan is the title of this section of the law. And the first thing on the merger plan is the name by which the merged school system shall be identified and known. And then it goes into other items that talk about how that takes place in the public hearing. It was brought to the county commissioners. The county commissioners approved it. Then it went to the state board of education, making the last in the minutes. Commissioner Moorfield said, instruct the clerk to send this to the State Board of Education for approval. And the State Board approved it. So the statute 115C67, in my view, is pretty clear. It says if you want to change the name or any part of that merger plan, you can't do it unless the General Assembly approves it.
So it would take local legislation.
It'd have to be an act of the General Assembly in the form of local bill to change the name of the school system.
So they talked about that at the last school board meeting, and I think that's what I heard them say.
So what are you saying? We got to change it here or the state house?
I think
the
state.
State house and the Senate.
Someone would have to request one of our representatives to introduce a local bill to change the name. And they would have to gather enough support to pass to be signed into law.
So this isn't something that requires a referendum or something from the county commissioners?
We
not according to this statute, no.
Well, we could pass a resolution.
that we don't want it changed.
And our legislators...
Want to make the motion, Tim?
Well, thank you. Bill and I have not talked about this. I promise you we haven't. All right. Everybody believes we talked.
I haven't heard anything on that.
No, I hadn't talked to you about it at all. But our local legislators would have a hard time going against what two key boards might say, we don't want you to do. And because to my understanding, Burlington does not want to see it changed.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, Burlington City. Did David Huffman call you today?
I spoke to the city attorney, a very frantic city attorney, right before I came in here. And I don't know what Burlington Board would do.
We'll find out in a day.
But I shared this statute with him.
I know Bill made a motion, but...
No, I didn't. I didn't make a motion.
I don't think we ought to be making a motion.
I got some stuff to say.
I was going to say, we need to take this up at a meeting.
Yes.
If you want to have it on the agenda,
it should be on an agenda, because I think that one of the things that I can see is that the people who live in Burlington get to go to the Burlington City Council and say what they think about it. Mm-hmm. I think the people of Alamance County should be able to come to their county commissioners and say what they think about it.
Right, I think.
And I also want to say that you threw in there that, or you mentioned, that it added Burlington's clout to the school system. As a graduate of the Western Alamance High School class of 1985 and the Alamance County school system, I think it had enough clout on its own and did not
I was demeaning Alamance, former school system.
I'm sure you were.
Certainly going to demean Burlington's.
I'm not either.
Because jointly, they are quite a machine, but needs to be better.
It's in the top 15% of the size of school systems across the country. Mm-hmm. It is a big organization.
I mean, if that is something we as a board want to put on the agenda, that's fine. We can do that at our next meeting.
Well, we can see what Burlington does tonight.
Yeah.
Tomorrow night. Go from there.
I also want to say briefly that I think that it's important to recognize that it's the school board's job to decide what the school system is, and under the way the statutes are presented to us, that's if people have an opinion about that, they should lobby the school board and mm-hmm. talk to them about what they think about it.
Well, if it hadn't have been part of the merger process, if it had been two systems that hadn't been merged, or two systems that merged themselves, I agree, we wouldn't have a dog in the fight too much. But I'm going on the spirit of the law. I was going on the spirit of the law when merger took place. When I went down to Raleigh, I collected everything I could. I had to pay $25 to get the minutes of the meeting. That I asked for the tapes. And Chuck Kitchen said, I'm not going to give them to you. You're going to charge me $25. I paid that $25. I had the minutes transcribed. Then I got the minutes from the school board. They violated the spirit of the law.
And it looks like it was three votes.
To go on a merger, to merge them. But the point is, I'm a stickler for the details on the merger process. The merger process, the spirit of the law was violated, in my opinion. And I even went down to the state legislature and took everything that I had to a lawyer, one of the lawyers in the legislature, and she told me, I said, here's the statute. Here's what their board did. This is what our board did. Do you not see a violation? She said, if there was a different governor and a different lieutenant governor who was on the state school board at that time, Dennis Wicker. Yeah, that I would be correct if it was a different school board and a different governor and a different lieutenant governor. And I said, well, isn't that odd that the truth differs based on who's in office? And she just looked at me like, well, yeah, that's the way we do things. And but the point is the county commissioners told them what their name was to be, school board and school system, and to go thinking they don't need our input now is, in my opinion, again, a breaking of the spirit of the process. That's just my personal opinion.
It would be an act. Your delegation would be the one that
Well, what we'll do is just see how, how the public hearing for the school system, and also see what Burlington has at their meeting tomorrow night, and we'll move from there.
I just wanted to make a couple comments mm-hmm. in response to Commissioner Sutton. I think it's a good idea to look at our fund balance and the fund balances of counties of similar size. In 2015, when we decided to up the fund balance, and maybe again in 2016, I'm not sure, we were advised by our auditor that the median, or the mean, I forget which one, fund balance of that comparative group was a little over 25%. Right. And so we came up with 25%. And I know in my own personal experience, where I used to work, we maintain they called it something else, but it was essentially the fund balance of something like 44% or somewhere in that neighborhood. And I know I serve on the Park Board; they have a fund balance that's up there. I forget what it is; it's 25 or 30%. I talked to David Cheek, City of Medmen; they're way up there. There's some rationale, and because of the fund balance policy and the achievement of fund balance. It caused our bond rating to go from a AA- to a AA. But, you know, I think it's great to look at it again. There's another point there. What was the next thing that you mentioned after fund balance?
Animal shelter.
And we'll find out for sure. But my recollection is that we came up with a deal with the city of Burlington that we agreed to a certain amount, and that was it.
Right.
So anything in excess of that was going to be borne by the city of Burlington. Right. And other municipalities, some may or some may not have participated
plus
in that
private
capital expense.
Funding also.
But,
yeah.
But our liability was limited to a set amount.
But I'm guessing you're going to have a meeting with Hardin and...
Yes, yes. Well, I'll have an update for you the next day or so.
Okay.
I have a little comment.
Okay.
About the fund balance. I think it's important to remember that the way that you think about, you want 3 months of savings to cover you in the event of a disaster or something like that. 12 months in the year, 8% is to pay the payroll for 1 month. So I believe that the reason that we think about a 24% fund balance is to cover the county's expenses for 3 months, 3 times 8 is 24, in case of a disaster, fire. You know, terrible things have been happening, seem like left and right, since the eclipse. So
actually, three months would be one-fourth of 12 months, or 25%.
Right, so 24%, 25%, and I think that's good to remember that, that those numbers aren't just pulled out of the air, that they're related to a financial principle, and that Dave Ramsey says for household financial budgeting, you should have 6 months of 6 months, 3 to 6 months of your family's expenses saved in case somebody loses their job or is seriously injured and can't work or something. So that's how I approach the question of how big the fund balance should be as a matter of planning for disaster. And
or chillers going out.
I know what I was going to say, Tim. The that 5 cent tax increase, about two thirds, maybe a little less, went to fund the budget request for the school system, and most of that went to teacher pay supplements. And then the other third, or a little bit more, went to our own staff wage and classification plan. And about taxing, yes, you could lower our tax rate temporarily if we decided to lower our fund balance, or you can increase the tax rate temporarily to achieve a fund balance. But once that balance, whatever it is that you want to achieve, then it really doesn't have any impact on your tax rate. It's not like it's going to be a recurring tax rate to raise the fund balance forever and ever. Once it's raised, then you're done.
Well, you get different commentaries on what you think is sufficient and what's excessive. Right. Back when it was 16% and we had the windfall of about $4 million, took it up to 16. Everybody thought, well, that's nice. That's double what the state's suggesting, which is 8%.
Well, that's not a suggested fund balance. That's the very minimum below which you start getting nasty letters.
No. Well, you get your letters, but it's not mandated. It's not mandated that it be at 8%.
That's 1 month.
There's a big difference. I'm not going to get into debating a whole lot more right now, but bottom line is that's not mandated. That is suggested.
Okay.
I think that's a good idea to get data and let's look at
it. Yeah, I agree.
I like that. Brian had actually mentioned something about upgrading our cameras and stuff, and he and I talked this week, and I told him I'd just bring this up in our commissioner comments, that I thought there's a room next door that will seat 135 people, and if we update it, possible look at that to where everybody can join us in our meetings. Looking at what he sent out, very few meetings ever go over that.
So you're suggesting move the commissioners' meetings to the
room
courthouse,
seat 135 people. So
I think that's a good idea.
That's an option that we can look into.
Our average meeting attendance over the past year has been 67 folks, which this room is rated for 49. As I said in the information I gave you, we're preparing this year and have budgeted this year to do camera replacements and some technological updates in here. We just wanted to check with the board to make sure before we do that, is this really where we want to be? Had suggested here at the historic courthouse. Had not thought about the other room, the overflow room itself, but that's a very viable option too. But that is up to the board.
Would that be less expensive to outfit that room as opposed to the historic courthouse?
I think we would be able to do it for hopefully close to what we budgeted to do this room. There's significant work that we would need to do at the historic courthouse. We would use the money we have budgeted now to help with that project. But we have not talked to the court about the overflow room, the civil court room. So we would want to do that for sure. We had talked to them about historic, but if the board is interested in that, No need to vote if there's a consensus.
That's why I brought it up.
Let me be sure I understand what we're talking about. We're talking about having all our meetings in there. Mm-hmm. The 9 o'clock and the whole Monday morning ones. And don't they have court at 9:30?
Well, and we may could flip them if we had to back to here on the morning, but we have to talk with the courts.
Yes, we would have to check with them to see how feasible would it be to try to have morning and evenings there. And even if we're only able, if that's what the board wants to do, if we're only able to have evenings there, there may be some mornings we could schedule it with them if they know their court schedule, which they usually do. Our thing was just to make sure we're doing what you want us to do as we make improvements to the space. If the board is there, if there's a consensus that you're interested in us contacting the court about the overflow space, we will do that and see what schedule would look like. We can come back and report if you'd like.
It accomplishes, I think, what we're after, to accommodate pretty much everybody that shows up to our meetings. Only one time a year normally that we exceed that limit.
Okay. I guess, yeah, we could ask them about it. I guess I'm a little confused about, so we would have this space fitted for the technology that we're talking about doing.
Well, and I mean, they would probably just leave what they have here, and we'd operate on it.
If the board was interested in going into overflow as the all-time meeting place day and night, we would talk to the court, and if that could work, we would only make updates in the overflow space. We wouldn't do anything else in here. I think we might relocate some of this equipment, maybe, but everything would be invested in that space. If we were told that we couldn't always get that room, because the daytime meeting will be an issue, because they do use the courtroom. If we can't work it out, then we would look at, could we make some investment there, and maybe some minimal investment here if this is just going to be used for mornings. That was not an option that we had considered, was using this other room, so we haven't looked at it as we had looked at the historic courthouse. But we can do that if the board's interested. Yeah, we'll be happy to look at it.
And I couldn't remember how many folks that said, but it's 135.
Yes.
Well, it never hurts to ask people questions about stuff. Mm-hmm. And find out.
Everybody okay? Let me look into it. Bring that back as a proposition of, can it be done, or will it, you know, will it be something we'd be interested in?
Okay. Yeah. We will. Thank you.
All right. Very good. Anything else? Hearing none. Meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.